Good evening, everybody. Distinguished guests, colleagues, friends. Very happy to welcome you to the M.B. Lee Distinguished Lecture in the Humanities for 2015. I'm Timothy O'Leary, head of the School of Humanities. We host this lecture series every year for the last 4 years and hope to continue doing so in future. The series is made possible by a very generous donation from Mr. M.B. Lee. Unfortunately, Mr. Lee can't be with us this evening, but there are representatives of his family with us, and we're very happy that they can be here. The series, the Distinguished Lecture in the Humanities, the M.B. Lee Distinguished Lecture in the Humanities, is a series that aims to promote the study of the arts and humanities, to share the study of the arts and humanities to a wider public in a way that is accessible, enriching, and stimulating, and in particular, to stimulate a desire to see the values of the humanities benefit the social well-being of Hong Kong. Bringing together value and humanities in the series concept is very appropriate this year, since we actually have a paper which is called Valuing Music. And it made me think I probably should say a couple of things, not very much, a few things about the idea or the question of the value of the humanities. One way to characterize the humanities as a whole would be to say that the humanities are involved the study of values across a wide range of human activity, a wide range of types of value across a wide range of human activities, both past and present. The values of culture, of the arts, the values of music, of ideas, of ways of thinking, and so on. So the humanities studies forms of value, but then we still have the question, or we can still think about, what is the value of that form of study itself? What is the value of this humanistic way of exploring cultural values? And that's always a topic of discussion and debate within the humanities, has been for a long time and will continue to be so. In a world that seems to value science, technology, and economic activity above all else, it can sometimes be hard to see or to explain in general what the value of the humanities are or could be. We who work in the humanities are sometimes tempted to speak of that value itself in terms of economic terms. And of course, humanities can contribute to economic value, but it's only one mode of contribution that the humanities can make. One way to think about the question then of the value of humanities, and I'm taking inspiration from the title of tonight's talk, is to think about value as a verb rather than as a noun. In other words, to think not what is the pre-existing and objective value of our work, of what we do, as if that could be precisely quantified and calculated, but to think of value as something that is created through the things that we do, through the ways that we value. In other words, as I said, to think of value as a verb rather than as a noun. And of course, the ways in which we value the humanities is itself rich and diverse in possibility. We can, for example, value the humanities as preservation of a cultural heritage, or as facilitating a certain cultural sophistication and accomplishment, or as an investigation of our past that might help us to work towards a better future, or as a fundamental re-examination of our ways of life and thought, or as a critical unfolding of the meanings embedded in our daily practices, or even we can think of the value, we can value the humanities in all of those ways at once. Because those ways of valuing will necessarily change depending on the time and the place in which we live and on the context in which we find ourselves, it's necessary to switch off your mobile device and other beeping thing. Well, you don't have to switch them off. Silent, flight mode, something like that. We value silence. Shh. Yep, there goes the water. Where was I? So the fact that there's ways that we value change, necessarily change, have to change depending on where we are, when we are, the context in which we are. We also need to have, so we have the humanities are a way of studying forms of human value. The humanities as a way of doing that itself can be valued in certain ways, but then we also need to continually rethink the ways that we are valuing the investigation of the values that we are investigating. And let's call that meta-valuing, and I will leave it at that, or I'll risk getting myself too tied up in knots and you'll all lose interest before we even start. So let's turn to why we're here, which is for tonight's MBLE Distinguished Lecture in the Humanities. Very happy to introduce to you tonight's distinguished lecturer, who is Professor Timothy D. Taylor from the Department of Ethnomusicology at the University of California, Los Angeles. Professor Taylor describes himself on his website, I guess he wrote himself, as, quote, an interdisciplinary social scientist focusing mainly on music and culture. He is, or in fact he tells me he was, he used to be a musicologist, now he's an ethnomusicologist, and as he says, also a social scientist. So his interest in music combines those a range of different disciplinary approaches. He's the author or the editor of 6 books and over 40 articles and book chapters. His teaching and research cover subjects from capitalism to globalization, identity, consumer culture, and more. Just to give you a flavor of his work, his books include titles such as Global Pop, World Music, World Markets, from 1997, Strange Sounds, Music, Technology, and Culture, from 2001, Beyond Exoticism, Western Music and the World, 2007, The Sounds of Capitalism, Advertising, Music, and the Conquest of Culture, from 2012, and also his recently completed and soon to be published with University of Chicago Press, his book, Music and Capitalism, A History of the Present. Turning to another aspect of Professor Taylor's work, or life, perhaps I should say, I'm very happy, speaking myself as an Irish man, I'm very happy to say that Timothy Taylor is an avid performer of Irish traditional music, especially in the flute. He is director of UCLA's Irish Music Ensemble. And for those of you who occasionally ever visit Long Beach, California, apparently he can often be found on a Sunday afternoon playing in a traditional Irish music session at a pub called the Auld Dubliner. And as someone who in my student years spent a lot of Sunday afternoons in pubs in Dublin listening to Irish traditional music, I'll certainly be visiting that place if I ever drop by Long Beach on a Sunday afternoon. All of that also, and a curious biographical fact about Professor Taylor is that I think we can explain a lot of that by the fact that he was actually born on St. Patrick's Day. I know what year that event occurred, but I'm not going to tell you. It's on his website, though. He's not very secretive about it. You can check it out later on. Or you can probably check it out right now. But don't, because you've all switched off your devices, right? So you can't do that. So today, Professor Taylor will be speaking on the topic of valuing music. At the end of his talk, we will have the opportunity for questions. There will be, I believe, helpers in the room with microphones, so I'll help to chair that. So you will have the opportunity, hopefully 15, 20 minutes for discussion afterwards. Okay, so now, please join me in welcoming Professor Timothy Taylor on Valuing Music.
Thank you, Timothy, for that very kind introduction, which was preceded by a very thoughtful discussion about the role of the humanities today. He said much about me being trained as a musicologist, but now a various sorts of social scientists. But you know, those of us who are interpretive social scientists are very humanistic, and I do not feel that I have left that aspect of my life at all. I'm very grateful and delighted to be here. I was telling Timothy before, I've given a few, or more than a few, but not that many keynotes and other such lectures in my life, but this is the most distinguished, and not simply because it is entitled A Distinguished Lecture. So it's really a great honor and privilege to be here. I'd like to thank Timothy and his staff for all of their hard work and all the logistics involved in bringing me here, Vivian Chu, Karen Leung, and Jovita Wong. Giorgio Biancoroso, I think, was the first person who contacted me about coming. And then I'd like to thank Chan Hing Yang, the chair of the music department, who has made me feel very welcome here, as has all of his colleagues. It's everybody here says, well, it's a small department. I said, yes, but it's a good department as well. So I've made many new friends among the faculty and the graduate students, and I look forward to keeping in touch when I get home. So I've been thinking for quite some time about how do we talk about something that's as meaningful and powerful as music in terms of its value. And I have written, as some of you know, something about music as a commodity. I've written a lot about music and capitalism. But this doesn't get very far, I think, in helping us to understand just how meaningful and powerful music can be, even for people who aren't musicians. And this is a paper that attempts to try to come to a better answer, or at least a better framework for addressing that question. So please bear with me. I'm going to read it. I'll do my best not to make you fall asleep. The question of the value of cultural goods, whether or not they are commodities, has been a frustrating one for decades. Most who have tackled the question have tended to rely mainly on Marx and Marxian notions of use value and exchange value, though these have their limitations, as I will discuss. Or there have been vague platitudes about the redemptive value of art, or functionalist interpretations of how music reinforces community beliefs or makes identity. All these might be true enough in certain social groups and certain historical moments. But I think we can find a better way to theorize the value of cultural goods that complements economic theories of value, such as Marx's, and those following his lead. If productive labor in Marx's thinking is productive because it produces surplus value for capitalists, surely labor or other sorts of work or action considered to be unproductive can nonetheless produce sorts of values other than those theorized by Marx. I am not concerned here with arguing that the labor that produces cultural commodities is somehow special, as so many authors are today. And I agree with Marx on the question of labor as being either productive, that is, it makes money for capitalists, or unproductive, it doesn't, even when that labor results in cultural goods. Our focus should be less on producing a taxonomy of labor or taxonomy of cultural commodities, and instead more on value. How are certain forms of labor valued compared to others, and how are the results of those labors, such as cultural goods, valued compared to others? I have found the anthropological literature on value to be useful in sorting out questions of the value of cultural goods, such as music. Historically, there have been two main ways of understanding value in this literature: Marxian conceptions of use value, exchange value, and value, determined by the amount of socially necessary labor time expended in the making of a particular commodity. The other main theory of value stems from the influential work of Marcel Mauss and concerns the cultural conceptions of value that obtained through the complex cultural practices of gift exchange. Most anthropological treatments of questions of value tend to veer back and forth between these two paradigms, although some authors have attempted to bring them closer together, as I will discuss. What interests me at this point in this presentation, however, is Arjuna Poddar's argument about what he calls regimes of value for goods, different regimes that exist in time and space. Goods circulate among specific social groups in specific times and places and have certain meanings, values, for those people in those regimes. For Poddar, the term, quote, does not imply that every act of commodity exchange presupposes a complete cultural sharing of assumptions, but rather that the degree of value coherence may be highly variable from situation to situation and from commodity to commodity. Regimes are relatively stable, though they can change over time. At this point, I realize I forgot to give you the roadmap. And here we are in the introduction. So it's not as long, as daunting as it may look. A Poddarized thinking on value figures importantly in Fred Myers's exceptionally useful overview of the subject of value, among other things, in his introduction to a book called Empire of Things. Myers observes that art objects exist in more than one regime of value, or what he calls value production. And drawing on the work of Annette Wiener, he argues for the importance of understanding how individuals and social groups create value in objects, whether those objects are commodities or treasures to be protected. An object's value, he writes, may shift through time as individuals or groups are forced to or elect to enter treasures into the marketplace, or as an ordinary commodity becomes revered by a collector or family members and takes on the value of an inalienable possession, one that cannot be replaced by another. Myers also notes that the value possessed by, I would say given to, objects is, quote, subject to slippage and therefore is problematic. It must be sustained or reproduced through the complex work of production, unquote. That is, production by social actors operating in various regimes. Myers identifies two regimes of value relevant to questions of cultural production, one defined by the opposition between art and the commodity, which he calls market framing, and the other defined by ethnic and national identity. So he's working on Aboriginal paintings, so this is why he's using these frameworks. And he makes a useful demand for further work, arguing that the market is not a separate domain, but, quote, a structure of symbolic transformation that does not necessarily erase all the distinctions embodied in objects, unquote. Other value systems can coexist with the market. And he writes, we must imagine that commodities and commoditization practices are themselves embedded in more encompassing spheres or systems of value production. Such systems not only recognize the existence of distinct regimes of value, but also combine and reorganize the activity from these various contexts into more complex mediations, or what he calls culture making. That is, even if something is produced as a commodity, it exists in other regimes of value. Commodities can become gifts, and they can become commodities again in never-ending processes of the circulation of goods. These moments of value transformation can be especially illuminating about the careers that goods can take, and I will examine a few such historical moments a bit later. The history of musics, especially non-Western musics, is littered with stories and studies of how a particular type of music, formerly outside the capitalist system or ignored by it, becomes sucked into it. But it is rarely the case that a previously uncommodified music simply becomes a commodity. All social systems have their own conceptions of value for music and everything else, and the movement of music to a different social system with different values, those of the commodity in the system of capital exchange, is seldom clear-cut. And older values don't necessarily disappear. Regimes of value can and do coexist and compete. Now, this section surveys some of the key writings on the question of value of cultural goods, particularly music. I think it is necessary to do so since values of cultural goods are seldom discussed, at least in our fields, and because the value of cultural goods is thought to be inchoate, ineffable, or as I said, interpreted in a functionalist framework. So what follows begins with Marx, but before proceeding, it is important to remember Marx's overall project, which was usefully summed up by David Graeber. Marx's theory of value was above all a way of asking the following question. Assuming that we do collectively make our world, that we collectively remake it daily, then why is it that we somehow end up creating a world that few of us particularly like, most find unjust, in which no one feels they have the ultimate control? The point of parsing Marx on questions of value, then, is not to engage in technical questions about value, but to attempt to understand just how, in this world few people much like, value is socially created, understood, and negotiated. In attempting to address questions of value of cultural goods, it is useful to distinguish consumption and production, even though this distinction isn't easily made. After all, Marx's understanding of exchange value was that one couldn't know what it was until a commodity was exchanged. Exchange value is thus dependent on consumption. And use value, of course, is just that, the value that a commodity has for someone who has a use for it and is willing to pay for it. The relationship between use value and exchange value is dialectical. Nonetheless, theories of cultural goods tend to emphasize one or the other, and separating them is useful for understanding the writings on the subject. The use value of cultural goods is notoriously difficult to grasp and characterize. What is the value of a sonata, a poem, a television program to its listener, reader, and viewer? While there are many beliefs about the value of art with which we are all familiar, art is uplifting, it is ennobling, educational, pleasurable, critical, and more, these are values for art that cannot really be captured in a single theory. They need to be studied historically, sociologically, ethnographically, so that the question becomes a specific set of questions about particular social groups and specific forms of cultural goods of particular places and times. Such studies exist, of course, with Pierre Bourdieu's distinction still perhaps the most famous and influential. Marx's conceptions of use value and exchange value aren't of much use in considering the value of cultural goods that are commodities. Marx makes it clear in his writings that the use value of cultural goods is a simple matter of enjoyment that lasts only as long as the music is heard, the poem read. Some services or use values, the results of certain activities or kinds of labor are incorporated in commodities. Others, however, leave behind no tangible result as distinct from the persons themselves, or they do not result in a saleable commodity. For example, the service a singer performs for me satisfied my aesthetic needs, but what I enjoy exists only in an action inseparable from the singer himself. And once his work, singing, has come to an end, my enjoyment is also at an end. I enjoy the activity itself, its reverberation in my ear. These services themselves, just like the commodities I buy, may be necessary or merely appear necessary, for example, the service of a soldier or a doctor or a lawyer, or they may be services which provide me with pleasure. I love this reverberation in all capitals. You know, I think this could be the beginning of reverberation studies if anybody wants to follow it up. Exchange value as expressed as price can appear to be a simpler matter, but it can't account for the wildly variable, even irrational, prices charged for various cultural goods. Millions of dollars spent for one painting, tens of dollars spent for another of the same size that took the same amount of labor time to produce. Will Vermeer paintings decline in value now that it is more than plausible that the Dutch master employed the high-tech devices of his time to paint his works, that they are less the products of a unique imagination? But it has been long understood that cultural goods can signify status or communicate socially in other ways. For theories of the value of cultural goods stemming from a perspective of consumption, we can go back at least to Thorstein Veblen, whose famous conception of conspicuous consumption in his book Theory of the Leisure Class, published in 1899 during the first modern phase of American consumer culture, the late 19th, early 20th centuries, has been widely cited and probably doesn't need to be rehearsed, but I will recall a single key sentence. Quote, "The basis on which good repute in any highly organized industrial community ultimately rests is pecuniary strength, and the means of showing pecuniary strength, and so of gaining or retaining a good name, are leisure and conspicuous consumption of goods." Theodor Adorno and other Marxish theorists for much of the 20th century were also concerned with questions of value of cultural goods as signs that communicated socially. Adorno's position was relatively stable over the many years he considered the question. Use values of cultural goods had been eclipsed by exchange value, and the cultural goods were now produced simply for the purposes of exchange value. The pleasure or enjoyment of listeners, viewers, readers is not a use value. It is simply a fetish, he thinks. And I'll talk about this more later. In one of the most important commentaries or updates or critiques of Marx since the Frankfurt and Birmingham schools, though scarcely departing from the Frankfurt school in many ways, Jean Baudrillard considered the importance of commodities in everyday life, writing that people in what he calls the age of affluence are, quote, "surrounded not so much by other human beings as they were in all previous ages, but by objects," unquote. Baudrillard thought that what consumer products signify had become more important than the products themselves. And he offered an influential advance on Marxian thought by arguing that there was more to understanding value than Marxian exchange value and use value. Drawing on and extending Veblen's influential arguments about conspicuous consumption, Frankfurt School Marxism, and the writings of Roland Barthes, Baudrillard argued, "Outside the field of its objective function, where it is irreplaceable, outside the field of its denotation, the object becomes substitutable in a more or less unlimited way within the field of connotations, where it assumes sign value. In the logic of signs, is that in that of symbols, objects are no longer linked in any sense to a definite function or need, precisely because they are responding here to something quite different, which is either the social logic or the logic of desire for which they function as a shifting and unconscious field of signification." Sign value is no less complex than use value or exchange value, and its understanding no less dependent on attending to the practices of specific social groups in particular times and places. Some people buy a washing machine because they need one. Some people buy a particular brand of washing machine, not simply because they need it, but because it has cachet. The same is true for cultural goods, such as music recordings. The hippest indie rock CD on one's shelf has sign value, at least for certain social groups. Simon and Garfunkel's concert in Central Park does not. Or rather, it did at one time for specific social groups and may yet again for them or for others. A particular good can have different sign values for different social groups at the same time in different regimes of value. I'm reminded in this context of the cartoon in the New Yorker magazine that simply showed the entrance to Elvis Presley's Graceland with two ticket windows. Oops. Ah! I'm sorry. Oh, I think this is in an older version. Okay, so fortunately I have it in here. Two ticket windows. One marked ironic, the other one marked non-ironic. All goods can have different sign values depending on habitus, context, point in time, geography, etc. All exist in regimes of value. Baudrillard also offers a particularly useful discussion on the question of value at an art auction. Here he attempts to explicate the quote, the immense process of the transmutation of economic exchange value into sign value, sign exchange value, the process of consumption considered as a system of sign exchange value, consumption as the conversion of economic exchange value into sign exchange value. Baudrillard's argument in essence is that art auctions are a sort of aristocratic ritual in which parity and the community of privilege is instituted. There is no interplay of supply and demand. Use value and exchange value are no longer correlated in an economic calculation during the bidding process. Anticipated use value does not increase during the auction. Economic exchange value and symbolic value become satellites of sign value. The value of a painting is its semiological value, the artist's signature, etc. In a word, its provenance. Paintings circulate among the aristocracy and accumulate prestige. A kind of surplus value is produced in this circulation, but it is very different from economic surplus value. The only real values in participating caste, as he calls it, are those produced and exchanged within the caste. The caste knows that its status derives from manipulation of artworks as the material of sign exchange value, and this caste disdains the universal values of art, culture, and so forth. Aesthetic enjoyment, he writes, spiritual commerce with works and the values labeled absolute are all that is left to those who cannot aspire to the privileged potlatch, unquote. The kind of social labor involved that transforms economic value and surplus value into sign value is a sumptuary operation. In this social world and regime of value, the ownership of the means of production is replaced by the mastery of the process of signification. Baudrillard's thinking on the question of value of paintings is useful as far as it goes, though outside the realm of high art and the exchange of unique objects such as paintings, his ideas do not readily transfer. However, his argument, as dependent as it is on the ritual, the existence of the auction itself, the participation in the auction, is a kind of analysis offered by David Graeber that I will return to later. Oh, I went back too far, sorry. To Fred Myers's two types of regimes of value of cultural goods that I mentioned before, I would add a third, what I will simply call distinction, which could be considered to be an aspect of Myers's market framing idea. But the cachet that certain individuals or works can enjoy can take value as expressed by price very far from value as determined by socially necessary labor time. And it therefore seems to me that breaking out this category is justified. Indeed, it is worth thinking about adding distinction to the value types of commodities and gifts, though that would have to be a project for a different time. I need to make it clear also that I'm not referring to Bourdieu's distinction, but the creation of value through the enhancement of a product's distinction in a market. We do not possess much of a sophisticated and rigorous theoretical framework by which to understand how this form of value creation works, though some early social scientists, Werner Zombart and Gabriel Tarde in particular, have offered useful beginnings. Zombart's concern was the origins of capitalism, and against his contemporary Max Weber, believed these origins to lie in the consumption of luxury goods in the aristocratic courts beginning in the 13th and 14th century, particularly in France, which was slowly generalized to the rest of the aristocracy and beyond by courtiers, Parisian mistresses, creating a culture of the consumption of fashionable goods that ultimately gave rise to capitalism across Europe. In a sense, we are talking about a form of sign value before Baudrillard's, but what interests me here is how certain goods and their sign values become fashionable, objects of ephemeral trends. Arjuna Potterai spends some time with Zombart, making much of his arguments. He argues that luxury goods should be seen, quote, not so much in contrast to necessities, but as goods whose principal use is rhetorical and social, goods that are simply incarnated signs, unquote. Luxury is a special register of consumption. The signs of this register in relation to commodities are some or all of the following attributes. One, restriction either by price or by law to elites. Two, complexity of acquisition, which may or may not be a function of real scarcity. Semiotic virtuosity, that is the capacity to signal fairly complex social messages, as do pepper in cuisine, silk in dress, jewels in adornment, and relics in worship. Specialized knowledge as a prerequisite for their appropriate consumption, that is, regulation by fashion. And five, a high degree of linkage of their consumption to body, person, and personality. I would add, crucially in this context, that cultural goods are frequently luxury goods as well in this sense, serving many, if not all, the same communicative functions that Ipaterai enumerates. More recently than Ipaterai's path-breaking study, which was published in 1986, some scholars have turned to the writings of the French jurist and sociologist Gabriel Tarde, a competitor of Emile Durkheim in the late 19th, early 20th centuries. I have found Tarde to be useful as well, though unlike many authors, view his refusal of the idea of society, or culture as we now understand it, to be problematic, although some those who employ him today are quite happy to set those concepts aside. The lack of a concept of society, however, meant that Tarde offered a more robust set of interrelated theories of influence, person to person through imitation, motivated by conversation, newspapers, and opinion. Conversation was crucial in the creation of value, he thought, affecting language and the language arts, religion and its spread, and politics. Even in the economic realm, conversation matters. For, he says, it standardizes judgments of the utility of various riches, creates and specifies the idea of value, and establishes a scale and system of values. Thus, superfluous chatter, a simple waste of time in the eyes of utilitarian economics, is actually the most indispensable of economic agents, since without it, there would be no opinion, and without opinion, there would be no value, which in turn is the fundamental notion of political economy. And he was writing this, 115 years ago. One of my main concerns here is to continue the interest of Clifford Geertz in questions of meaning to encompass those of value. Geertz's insistence that the focus of analysis should be on what is meaningful to social actors was and remains compelling. What people find to be meaningful is what they have invested themselves in, something that resonates with their beliefs, their view of the world, the things that matter to them. Value is a more precise way of attempting to comprehend meaning. Concerning ourselves with social actors and their understanding of meaning and value, and their actions based on those beliefs, helps move beyond functionalist explanations of social behaviors, which is still quite common in the music fields. Let me turn now to an examination of value in production, beginning again with Marx and the Marx-oriented authors. Marx himself had little to say about cultural goods, and his few mentions of them are notoriously insufficient. For example, he wrote in several places, including Capital, that the builder of a musical instrument is a productive laborer, but the player of that instrument is not, meaning that the commodity produced by the labor of the former possesses value and will yield profit for capitalists, but the labor expended by the latter, the performer, is neither productive and therefore not profitable. This is not particularly satisfactory, as Raymond Williams once pointed out. Nonetheless, Marx's labor theory of value does capture much, even most, of the labor of the production of cultural goods. Musicians who are paid to union scale, composers who are paid to prearranged fees, compose the vast majority of the world of working musicians. Rock or other sorts of stars are a tiny minority. For workaday artists at the moment when a cultural good is produced, Marx's labor theory of value seems to be in effect almost everywhere. Painters are paid by the size of the canvas, composers by the length of the work and the size of the forces employed. The New York City chapter of the American Federation of Musicians posts this table on its website. So you can see, very clear cut, 3-hour session. You don't need to read all the numbers, I just wanted you to see. That is very clear cut. And Meet the Composer, a New York-based foundation that fosters commissions for composers, publishes on its website a booklet that includes its recommended commission fees. So you can see, I don't know if you can see in the back row, but it's, you know, size of forces, you know, under instrumentation, length of time, a bunch of set fees. This table lays out the relationship between labor time as measured by length of the work and labor time spent as writing for a number of instruments. Yet there is still a good deal of wiggle room. The range between some figures is variable but large. Some high figures are nearly five times the low figures for a single commission type. This variability and the well-publicized deals made by major artists indicates that it is not always the artist's labor that determines value. Whatever the value of a cultural good is, it cannot be captured by economic theories alone. Value is economic, cultural, social, situational, and more. While I view Marx's labor theory of value as immensely useful, it can never encompass all forms of value creation, which is why the anthropological literature on value considers questions of non-economic forms of value to be so significant. And since Marx's time, the rise of advertising, marketing, and now branding, which are huge industries, have in various ways attempted to create or add value to commodities. These other sorts of value creation can augment the labor theory of value to increase the exchange value of cultural goods, though I will have to consider this issue elsewhere, and I did in the music department the other day in my talk. There we go. So I opened this presentation by noting that the history of music around the world offers many examples of the problem of shifts in regimes of value, and it's time that we examine some specific cases. I'm particularly interested in historical moments when an older regime is faced with a new one, sometimes being supplanted by it, sometimes competing with it. Regimes can and do coexist. My main examples will concern economic value. The junctures that are perhaps most illustrative are the Western transition from feudalism to capitalism and its ramifications for musical production and consumption in the late 18th century, the rise to dominance of exchange value in what was called late capitalism of mid-20th century, and the present, in which old modes of commodifying music, creating exchange value for it by recording it for mass distribution and sale, are faltering. And new mechanisms of the creation of value for those musical goods today are emerging, some of which are non-economic values that can be converted to economic ones. Transition from feudalism to capitalism was as massive as it was slow and uneven and geographically distinct. I do not intend to address this transition in its entirety here. That would require many books. I'm instead focused on the crisis of use value of instrumental music. What was this music for if it were no longer for the entertainment of the nobility? The expression and representation of the feudal order, the power of an employer, whether aristocratic or church, over an employee. All of these things is what music used to be for. The entry of musical works into the marketplace and the creation of exchange value for them called into question the use value of musical works, instrumental works in particular. I've addressed a version of this issue before in a different context. This is my Beyond Exoticism book, for those of you who know that. Here I want to focus on this problem as a question of value. During the feudal era, music that was subject to being exchanged in a market was mainly for entertainment or worship. Its use value was clear. But with the rise of capitalism and the entry of music into the marketplace, use value was not always so easy to understand. Operas and ballets had stories, plots, songs had words. They contained textual or plot meanings. They were about something. Instrumental music, however, was another matter. If it had been entertainment or background music or dance music for the nobility in the past, what was it now? At the moment that exchange value was being created for music in the marketplace, there was a crisis of use value, I'm saying. This problem surfaced in Jean-Jacques Rousseau's Dictionnaire de Musique from 1767, in which, under the entry for sonata, he wrote, "In order to know what all these jumbles of sonatas mean, one would have to be like a crude painter who must write above his figures. This is a tree. This is a man. This is a horse." I shall never forget the flash of wit of the famous Fontenelle, who, finding himself overburdened with these interminable symphonies, cried out in a fit of impatience, "Sonata, what do you want of me?" I think this is my favorite quotation in all of Western music history. The solution to the problem of use value was at the time of the advent of exchange value for music, was the rise and embrace of a discourse that held that musical and other artworks did not have to have any function at all. They existed for their own sake. This, of course, is the discourse of aesthetics, or art for art's sake, which was inaugurated tellingly by Adam Smith. Contemplating the thorny problem of instrumental music, Smith attempted to account in various ways for how it might signify in an essay published in 1795 entitled Of the Nature of That Imitation Which Takes Place in What Are Called the Imitative Arts, in which he wrote that music seldom means to tell any particular story or to imitate any particular event or in general to suggest any particular object distinct from that combination of sounds of which itself is composed. Its meaning, therefore, may be said to be complete in itself and to require no interpreters to explain it. What is called the subject of such music is merely, as has already been said, a certain leading combination of notes to which it frequently returns and to which all its digressions and variations bear a certain affinity. After comparing music to painting, Smith continues. The melody and harmony of instrumental music, on the contrary, do not distinctly and clearly suggest anything that is different from that melody and harmony. Whatever effect it produces is the immediate effect of the melody and harmony, and not of something else which is signified and suggested by them. They, in fact, signify and suggest nothing, unquote. Instrumental music was thus an empty vessel that could be filled up by later ideologies. Art, a relatively recent ideological construction, only emerged when it had fully entered the marketplace. Once artists had to compete with each other in a capitalist marketplace, proclaiming themselves to be artists, then later geniuses, was a way to attempt to stand out in the market. Perhaps the most famous or infamous statement of this history appears in Jacques Attali's book Noise, in which he argues that music's values before it entered the marketplace were values or meanings in ritual. Values in church and court, use values, and those values still obtain in pre-industrial cultures. But after Western European music entered the marketplace, it had to have a monetary or exchange value, since it was going to be sold in ways that it hadn't been sold before. Attali writes that the process of valuation, quote, took place in opposition to the entire feudal system in which the work, the absolute property of the Lord, had no autonomous existence, unquote. Attali discusses the process of assigning values at length. For my purposes, the most important of these was the introduction of effective copyright laws, which emerged in the late 18th century, and which were the first laws protecting the rights of composers, who were among the new owners of musical commodities. Once composers could profit from their music, the old system of patronage had effectively been broken, necessitating valorizations for the new musical object, giving rise, in other words, to modern aesthetics. Aesthetics was a way to explain the meaning of art, to create a kind of value for it that was both apart from the earlier feudal values and current economic ones. Art became thought of not only as set apart from the marketplace and economic values, but autonomous, aloof from the everyday. The use value of art had become its supposed distance from society, which gave it a vantage point from which to critique society. Now, here's my second historical case. I'm not trying to be comprehensive. These are just two historical junctures. Following the rise of what we would now call the music industry, beginning in the 19th century, an era dominated by sales of sheet music, such sales began to be so profitable that by the end of that century, there was a major industry, at least in the U.S., centered in New York City, that was dedicated to the composition and sales of sheet music, primarily to stage performers, whose popularity, it was hoped, would influence the sales of sheet music to the general public. New York publishers hired what were called song pluggers, whose job it was to give away their company's products to stage performers. Every effort was made, and no expense was spared, it seemed, in this endeavor. Popular song structures became simpler, vocal lines became written more and more for average voices, and the vocabulary used in lyrics was also simplified, also that anyone at home could play and sing almost any popular song. In songwriting advice offered to a journalist in 1920, the great songwriter Irving Berlin focused as much on making songs singable and thus sellable as advice about the craft of songwriting, concluding, quote, the songwriter must look upon his work as a business, That is, to make a success of it, he must work and work and then work. All caps in the last one. The advent of recording processes in the late 19th century, in the form of player piano rolls and phonograph recordings, produced new sorts of musical goods, recorded sound. Later, radio and then sound film served to disseminate the products of the music industry even more. The industrialization of the production of popular music as both sheet music and recorded sound, and the hawking of it, not just by song pluggers, but by the advertising industry, which had emerged around the same time in this industrialized music industry in the late 19th century, resulted in increasingly standardized musical products. These new cultural goods were the cause of a good deal of consternation among many artists and intellectuals, particularly in Europe, who keenly felt what they believed to be the threat of mass culture. For these intellectuals, conceptions of the value of these cultural goods began to shift. Exchange value increasingly came to be seen as more important than use value. Adorno, Max Horkheimer, and others believed that late capitalism, as they often called it, mid-20th century Western capitalism, represented a new form of capitalism in which the value of cultural and other goods was changing. While artworks previously were commodities most of the time in late capitalism, they deliberately proclaimed their commodity status. Previously, the use value of artistic commodities, as Adorno makes clear in many writings, was to employ its autonomy from society to critique society, to make an argument. But in late capitalism, only exchange value remains, Adorno believed. In some of his earliest publications, Adorno addresses questions of the value of cultural commodities, industrially produced for the purpose of exchange in a large market. Writing in On the Fetish Character of Music and the Regression of Listening in 1938, Adorno claimed, quote, "The more inexorably the principle of exchange value destroys use values for human beings, the more deeply does exchange value disguise itself as the object of enjoyment," unquote. Elsewhere he argued, quote, "Today, music is considered ethereal and sublime, although it actually functions as a commodity. Today, the terms ethereal and sublime have become trademarks. Music has become a means instead of an end, a fetish," unquote. Later, Horkheimer and Adorno tackled questions of value in Dialectic of Enlightenment in their famous chapter on the culture industries, making some of the same points. No object has an inherent value. It is valuable only to the extent that it can be exchanged. The use value of art, its mode of being, is treated as a fetish. And the fetish, the work's social rating, misinterpreted as its artistic status, becomes its use value, the only quality which is enjoyed. Horkheimer and Adorno incorporated something of a recognition of what we would now call sign value in their assessment. Quote, "What might be called use value in the reception of cultural goods is replaced by exchange value. In place of enjoyment, there are gallery visiting and factual knowledge. The prestige seeker replaces the connoisseur," unquote. Horkheimer and Adorno's argument that exchange value had replaced use value, and that use value is really a fetish, was for them not simply an argument about the cultural industries, but an argument about the nature of late capitalism in general, in which exchange value was all that mattered. Among those concerned with questions of the value of cultural goods, Adorno's position on the question of value remains largely intact, though it has not gone entirely uncontested. Horkheimer and Adorno's employment of the term fetish in what I've just quoted is not a Marxian employment, as Adorno made clear in a draft version of an article called A Social Critique of Radio Music. And here's a quote from there where he says, "something adored without any immediate relation to its actual being." Right, so that's not what Marx meant by fetishism. Marx's conception of commodity fetishism was not about displays of status, but rather was a way of conceptualizing and labeling how the diffuse and hidden labor of many was masked by the commodity form. As he famously put it, quote, "To the producers, therefore, the social relations between their private laborers appear as what they are. That is, they do not appear as direct social relations between persons in their work, but rather as material relations between persons and social relations between things," unquote. The fetishism as adoration that Horkheimer and Adorno described has taken many forms. It can be a marker of social status, they noted. Knowledge of art contributes to cultural capital in Bourdieu's thinking. And today, one can encounter all kinds of things said about the high arts, classical music, any other high art, about how it is uplifting or educational. All of these ideas about classical music or the high arts could consider to be values in the sense that I'm going to talk about, though they would need to be studied specifically, values for particular social groups and particular places and times. But for Adorno, any activity other than the philosophical apprehension of a work's critique is a form of fetishism and not really use value. So far, I've been mainly, though not exclusively, relying on theories by Marx and derived from Marx to explore conceptions of value of music as a cultural good. Now I want to begin to tease out other concepts of value that are not based on economic theories. So we'll return to some of the anthropological theorizations of value that will help with this argument. I will theorize what I call meaningful action as a way that value is created apart from economic value. I derive this concept both from Clifford Geertz's concern for meaning and from other anthropologists such as David Graeber and Michael Lambeck, who view action as productive of value, but not just action that is considered to be labor in Marx's sense. Graeber, for example, writes, quote, "Value is the way our actions take on meaning or importance by becoming incorporated into something larger than ourselves," unquote. And then continuing, "First, value is the way actors represent the importance of their own actions to themselves as some part of larger whole. Second, this importance is always seen in comparative terms. Some forms of value are seen as unique and incommensurable, others are ranked. For yet others, such as money and market systems, value can be calculated precisely, so that one can know precisely how many of item A are equivalent to one item B. Third, importance is always realized through some kind of material token, and generally is realized somewhere other than the space it is primarily produced." Graeber later summarized his thinking and value by advocating that we return to an older tradition stemming from Herder, quote, "one that understands human beings as projects of mutual creation, value as the way such projects become meaningful to the actors and the worlds we inhabit as emerging from those projects rather than the other way around," unquote. For his part, Michael Lambeck makes a distinction between economic value, production, or making something, and what he calls ethical value, that is to say, doing something, right? Making something, doing something, which he says are both important forms of value but are not the same thing, for the latter cannot be objectified and thus circulated. Lambeck wants to bring together the material and the ideal, which means it is important to attend to values as activities, acts, works, practices. Lambeck's overall argument is to make a distinction between values, quote, "internal to a practice and those external to it," unquote. And he actually offers a musical example. So he makes a distinction between playing the violin for its own sake, which would be ethical value. And he says this is a different kind of value than playing the violin to make a living. You know, both are forms of value, but they're not the same. Here it is useful to distinguish between what Marshall Solins has in a different context called conventional values and intentional values. Conventional values are those that are dominant or hegemonic, but individual social actors have their own ideas, their own projects, and so employ intentional values. These are derived from conventional values, yet at the same time can influence them. Solins concludes by writing, "The dialectics of history then are structural throughout, powered by disconformities between conventional values and intentional values, between intersubjective meanings and subjective interests, between symbolic sense and symbolic reference. The historical process unfolds as a continuous and reciprocal movement between the practice of the structure and the structure of the practice." David Graeber, who was Solins' student, actually, draws on the idea of intentional values by arguing that people's actions take on meaning for them. Whatever things and acts people invest themselves in possess value for them. But in order to understand value, we need to pay attention to it historically, culturally, and sociologically. For what one social group in one place and time finds valuable may not be the same thing that same social group invests in a different place and time, since there are regimes of value, which one considered to be akin to Solins' conventional values. Understanding value means understanding particular social groups and their practices and the ways that regimes of value can be hierarchized according to various systems of power, as we have learned from feminist scholars, post-colonial scholars, and others who study structurally oppressed groups. This is a conception of value that works both for cultural producers and consumers. Value is determined by people's actions, which both reveal and confer meaning. What I'm calling meaningful action is a source of meaning, a repository of meaning, a currency of meaning. And we continue to require a Potterize and Myers emphasis on the concept of regimes of value, or Solins' conventional values, not just for cultural goods, which undergo changes in their careers, but for social actors who change as well as they age, move up or down the class ladder, or possess shifting amounts of various forms of capital in Bourdieu's sense. What people find to be meaningful, what they value, shifts as their positionalities shift. All this greatly complicates Adorno's conception of value, with which I am largely in agreement as a theory of the value of cultural goods produced by the mainstream cultural industries. But if one attends to real social actors in real places in real times, complexity appears, and quickly. Value and consumption is shifting and negotiated, dependent on a works or cultural goods presence in one social group rather than another, in one geographical location rather than another, in one historical moment rather than another, in one culture rather than another, and in one regime rather than another. Value is volatile because cultures are never static, and there is more than one social group in the world. When value appears fixed or stable, or hegemonic, conventional, as Solins would say, it is only because there are many people and institutions working to keep it that way. Just think of, you know, the amount of money cities spend on art museums and things like that. And there are people struggling to increase or diminish the value of this or that, this cultural good, that cultural good, in whatever regime of value they find themselves. Struggles, contestations, battles over value are social. Now let's move to a consideration of a new regime of value of musical goods. If the transition from feudalism to capitalism created a crisis of use value for cultural goods, at least those commonly consumed by social elites, followed by the rise to dominance of exchange value over use value in the mid-20th century in Western capitalism, then the transition in the last few decades to a globalized, digitalized, and financialized form of capitalism that is usually called neoliberal has created a crisis in exchange value of musical goods, since it is now easy to obtain them free. I would not characterize today's musical goods as gifts, however. Just because someone doesn't pay for something doesn't make it a gift. Discourses of sharing, piracy, and others have proliferated in recent years as commentators have attempted to grasp the different ways of exchanging goods in this economy. The vast majority of recordings that people download were conceived and produced as commodities, after all, even if many people don't pay for them. Today's digitalized musical goods exist and move through new regimes of value, though they coexist with regimes with longer histories. Digitalization has been much discussed. It's also made it easier for musicians to realize exchange value from their own labor by selling directly to fans over the internet, though there remains the problem of drumming up a large audience, an audience willing to pay for recordings. According to Courtney Holt, a former executive at MySpace Music and the head of Maker Studios, quote, once you have an audience, you can make money, unquote. But generating an audience remains difficult without a major recording label contract and a label with deep enough pockets to pay for marketing, advertising, promotion, and branding. Much has been written about the decline of the recording industry in the last decade or so, but it has been unwilling to or slow to adapt to the changing reality of music consumption. The industry has attempted to find ways to continue to sell its products, whether as a manufacturer of physical recordings to be sold at rapidly disappearing retail record stores or online venues such as iTunes, or increasingly acting as a rentier by licensing copyrighted material for use in advertising, broadcasting, and film, and to streaming services such as Spotify. Old capitalism, or perhaps better put, old think in the recording industry, is in what seems to be a perpetual game of finding and generating new revenue streams as sales of recordings decline, except for Adele. The industry has assiduously sought, even created, economic value by exploiting its back catalog, issuing CDs with bonus tracks, hiring DJs to mix classic tracks, releasing massive box sets of a single musician or band accompanied by a lavish booklet, the 2014 unveiling of the complete Beatles in mono on vinyl, a limited edition, naturally, selling for well over $300 US, serves as a good example. These and other measures demonstrate the ways that the recording industry has attempted to convert the devotion of fans, the value that fans and fan groups have for certain musicians, bands, and recordings, into economic value. Such an example helps to point out how much value is never static, unlike in Attali's thinking. The recording industry still attempts to profit from cultural production in older regimes of value. There's been a lot of questioning about how this might be done. There are discussions of how to monetize digitalized music, as well as many other online activities. A Google search for monetize and music results in over 1 million hits. That was a few months ago, it's probably more now. Many websites offer advice for musicians on how to monetize their music through digital and other means. If it is true that neoliberal capitalism is a form of capitalism that can commodify anything its agents desire, commodification as the creation of exchange value is certainly still with us. But it must nonetheless be acknowledged that other forms of value creation of cultural goods are arising under neoliberal capitalism. I would argue that we are currently witnessing the rise of a new regime of value of cultural goods, measured less by exchange value and more by viral popularity, as registered by YouTube and various social media platforms, or through the creation and sharing of information about music through playlists and other means. These represent two regimes of value, both of which are new in neoliberal capitalism, though with historical antecedents and practices such as the creation of mixtapes to give to friends. YouTube popularity is a kind of collective creation of value, which is fairly easily made commensurable with economic forms of value. The creation and sharing of playlists is a much more individual way to create value, though playlists can be shared or viewed by many followers on social media. So let's take this first regime first. I said there's two new ones. Everyone by now has heard of the YouTube video of a musician or band that has gone viral with millions of views. This represents a new sort of value creation, a new regime with which old ones are competing, particularly old capitalism, which simply tries to commodify, though increasingly inventive, complex, and numerous ways. This new regime of value represents what is believed to be a more organic way of finding music and expressing approbation for it, along with millions of one's fellows, out of the curatorial control of the music industry. This is a form of popularity that is not measured by sales, though can be converted to economic forms of value. Here, the regime of value that I call distinction above, or earlier, come into play. Gabriel Tarde's theories about the importance of imitation, opinion, and conversation are still useful in today's world, with a mass media much more massive than experienced by Tarde, as well as the rise of social media. Opinion can be articulated and disseminated much more widely, generating eddies and currents and pools of value. Value can thus be created, or thought to be created, in a variety of ways, through socially necessary labor time, but also through other means, whether through gift exchange or conceptions of Zombartian fashion or Tardian imitation, which is supported by conversation. These modalities of the creation of value coexist, intermingle in complex ways. A producer of a cultural good can employ a cool hunting firm to make its product seem cooler, to make it fashionable. But those who do that work are usually working in a regime of value largely contiguous with the labor theory of value. Capitalism is constantly impinging upon and drawing on, as Anat Singh argues in her work, these other modes of the creation of value in order to create exchange value to generate profit. There are services that one can sign up for to generate YouTube traffic, such as the brazenly named YouTube Views Buy, which offers 1 million real views for $900 US. And such services compensate employees based on the labor theory of value. Just as there are regimes of value, there are regimes of the production of value. Nonetheless, for the most part, at least as of today, users are increasingly decided what is popular together. This is rather like the early days of radio in the US in the 1920s, when part of the thrill of listening in was knowing that there were thousands, millions of others doing the same thing at the same time. Unlike radio, with YouTube and other online platforms, however, It is possible to know how many others are participating, and it is possible to write comments for others to view on YouTube's site. This sort of value is new and is incommensurate with values in the regime of capitalism in which music in the form of recorded sound was more easily commodified. But this new value can be converted into exchange value. Sometimes YouTube sensations result in recording contracts. It's increasingly the case that a record label will wait and see how much of a value a musician can create on social media before offering her a recording contract. Popular acclaim for an artist or recording on YouTube can result in a number of ways of generating exchange value for musicians or copyright holders. An article in Rolling Stone online spelled out these strategies, which I put in the table, might be too small. This is just sort of, just for your information, you can see the many ways that musicians are making money apart from just making a recording and selling it. Clearly, the creation of value in today's digital world is not a simple question of the production of saleable commodities. Multiple strategies of the creation of exchange value exist, harvested from newer forms of value creation in social media. Before the digital sharing of music became widespread, the main way that music industry tracked the success of recordings was through retail sales. Billboard magazine, the main chronicle of the music industry in the US, began publishing charts based on sales data in 1936. But in the new regime of value today, value is measured by popularity registered in various social media platforms. The music industry has come to recognize other forms of value as registered in popularity, not measured by sales. In December 2010, Billboard introduced a new chart, indeed a new sort of chart, the Social 50 chart. This chart, according to Billboard, incorporates the following metrics: weekly additions of fans across Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram, reactions and conversations across Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook, and views to an artist's Wikipedia page, according to music analytics provider Next Big Step. I think this is a big deal, right? It's not based on sales and retail establishments. According to Billboard's chart director, Silvio Pietro Luongo, quote, "The Social 50 provides a weekly snapshot of the artists that music fans engage with the most in the social arena, which in today's world is a significant validation of their investment in an act," unquote. While YouTube might provide the most spectacular example, its website offers advice on how to monetize one's content. There are other ways that users can generate value, ways that are more individual. Well, actually, I wanted to show you something. So this is what this looks like. Every time I check, Justin Bieber is always number one. And then speaking of regimes of value, you know, being related to age and, you know, other forms of positionality, I never heard of these of number two and number four. I'm too old. While YouTube might provide the most spectacular example, the creation of a playlist that is also shared is also a way of creating value, I would say. The creation of a kind of token. Remember, these values theorists say that value needs to be stored in some way. Value creation through action needs to be stored. And a shared playlist is one such storage mechanism. It is no accident that after many fits and starts, the music search and or streaming services that seem to be the most successful are those that combine social networking with music. One can create playlists in Spotify and share them with friends, for example, and one can permit Spotify to notify Facebook friends about what one is listening to. All of the major music streaming platforms, Spotify, Google Play, Apple Music, make it easily possible to share a selection or playlist with friends and various social networks, such as Facebook, Twitter, and others, as well as sharing with friends who are exclusive to that platform. Some platforms include listener comments. Software designers are increasingly building in such social networking mechanisms into a variety of applications so that users can share their playlists, their tastes, with others. All this is part of the much remarked upon commodification of social relationships under neoliberal capitalism, but users are also creating value for themselves in finding new ways to share the music that they like. Finding and sharing in today's world of digital plenitude increasingly matters. With a bewildering variety of music available to stream, to download, searching and finding what one likes, and finding more music based on what one already likes, has become a driving force in the music industry. Streaming music services place a premium on users being able to find more of what they already like. Some, such as Pandora, ask users if they like a particular section, and if so, attempt to find more similar to it. Since the IMS people are here, I have to tell you, I'm a Bach lover, so I've put on, but I have to say, excuse me, but I like the sound of the piano more than the harpsichord. So if Pandora gives me Bach keyboard music on the harpsichord, I dislike it, but then I get more harpsichord music. I don't get the piano music. So forgive me, 18th century specialists. Last.fm and iTunes Radio allow users to create a personalized station that play what users like. Last.fm's website splash page says, quote, discover more music. Last.fm is a music discovery service that gives you personalized recommendations based on the music you listen to, unquote. All of this searching, finding, and sharing is a form of curation, a term I am deliberately using in a broad sense. But what about people who simply like what they like, one might wonder, without anybody's influence? Or is it that simple? We like what we like in part because of the taste of others we know, our parents, siblings, partners, children, friends, students, as well as the taste of others we don't know, trusted DJs, critics, valued indie labels, music supervisors. Somebody somewhere has invested time and energy, labor, or action, in locating, collecting, organizing, categorizing, and presenting music that others find to be meaningful. There was curation in the old music industry as well, of course, since record labels employed A&R men, you know, artists and repertoire, men to seek and find new musicians to record. And there were radio station DJs who decided what to broadcast, although this is less and less common. Today, however, curatorial authority is much more diffuse, available to anyone with access to a computer or tablet or smartphone and the internet. This form of creation is one regime of value creation in today's neoliberal capitalism, I am saying, in which different regimes of value coexist. Value is meaningful action in curation as people take time finding, championing, and sharing the music they like with others. But as with anything social, there are and will continue to be struggles over what is valued and what isn't, what particular representatives of non-economic forms of value are converted into economic forms, and more. It's short. The problem with many discussions of the value of cultural goods is that the theory is frequently too broad. Practices of production and consumption are too varied in space and time among different social groups for a one-size-fits-all argument. There are too many cultures, too many different social groups. And any and all of the theories of value that I've discussed can be useful depending on the time, place, social group, and situation. Cultural goods are produced under wildly varying circumstances, from the lone individual in a room with paint and canvas, or computer and word processor, or piano and staff paper, to film or television with dozens or even hundreds of people working together. There are different fields of cultural production, different ways of laboring, different modes of dissemination, different strategies of marketing, with wildly variable amounts of money spent. And modes of consumption can be even more varied than those of cultural production. In keeping with Gertz's insistence that ethnography and analysis should be focused on individual social actors in order to attempt to understand what is meaningful for them, considerations of value must be concerned with real people living in real times and places who are parts of real social groups and cultures. Otherwise, we'll be simply rehashing old functionalist arguments about the value of an activity or practice, the value of music and ritual, say, or old technicalized Marxian arguments about the value of commodities, such as easy assumptions of popular music as being just a commodity. I am not simply making an argument for specificity here, but an argument about it. Any study, not theory, of value needs to be situational, paying attention to culture, history, and the social, and the particular social groups that find or fail to find value in whatever cultural goods they consume. There cannot be a one-size-fits-all theory of value of cultural goods beyond what I have amplified and offered here. The realization that value is the result of action and that people continually make it and remake it in ways that are meaningful to them. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Taylor. I particularly like the line, the quote from the MySpace executive who said, once you have an audience, you can make money. I noticed some of the audience is running out. Guys, we need to make some money here. Where are you going? Okay. So we have a very scarce commodity now, time, but we do have a few minutes to take questions. There are a couple of people in the room who will, there's already one hand up, thank you, Robert, and there's a microphone on its way to you. So if you want to ask a question, put up your hand and we have microphones and you can get.
Thank you very much for your talk. I wanted to bring up something that was mentioned right at the beginning, this idea of meta value. How do you situate your own critique of value within the new regimes of value that you identified at the end? I.e., in the world of social media, the kind of commentary that you're offering on value.
I think it has to be taken seriously because, you know, musicians and fans are taking it seriously. The music industry has been pretty quick and pretty adept at taking all of this and learning how to profit from it. But I think that's a process that, you know, is never going to go away. But you know, any sort of process or set of processes that empowers fans, I think, is a good thing.
In the world of MOOCs, and we're increasingly for universities and academics who have Facebook presences and use social media, that the kind of critique you're offering is a sort of neutral point where you can observe other kinds of regimes of value, but you yourself aren't immersed in a regime of value. But of course, we're all kind of enmeshed in different competing, as you demonstrated. So how do you situate yourself in that world?
I see what you mean. So, well, it depends. You know, I regularly teach a class called Music and Media. And for several years, when I was working on my book, which was a history of music and advertising, I would present material in that class. And I told people in the class, I do not want you recording the lectures or taking pictures of the PowerPoints because this is all my intellectual property. And nobody knew that history. Then the book came out, and you know, so now I don't tell the students that anymore. If my university wanted me to participate in a MOOC or wanted to make iPod recordings of my lectures, I don't think I would like it. But you know, at least in the U.S., you know, American universities, especially I think public universities like mine, which have less and less money coming from public revenues funding us, we are now increasingly forced to find other revenue streams, just like the music industry. So I don't think it will be too long before, or maybe it's already happening at UCLA in the science classes. You know, in my more obscure corner of the university, you know, the tiny department of ethnomusicology, they might not have noticed me. But personally, I would try to retain control over it as much as possible. But there may come a time when I don't have that option. Who knows? Maybe that's what make me decide to retire.
Hi. I really like the whole sociological, anthropological picture that you've presented here. One thing that you have essentially bracketed throughout the talk is any consideration of the formal characteristics of music or of the psychological effects of the music, even the aesthetic dimensions of any aesthetic analysis of the content, as we now call it these days. Given that you have this description of how the value regime is now changing in the world of social media and YouTube and all these things, how do you think this is going to affect content? And you mentioned Adorno and Horkheimer discussing the transition from the ethereal and the sublime to the ethereal and sublime as brand names. I don't think there has ever been an ethereal or a sublime viral video on YouTube. These are not aesthetic categories that lend themselves to viralness. So I'm wondering, what do you think is going to be the impact on the landscape of aesthetic possibilities in the future as a result of these changes? Thank you.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of rich questions there. I would say, I mean, it's true. I bracketed, as you said, more sort of formal technical discussions of music. But I found this value literature to be so rich, and I'm currently actually writing something about musical performance as a medium of value. And the idea of the medium of value comes from David Graeber's book on value. He doesn't talk about it very long, and he doesn't talk about music. He talks about ritual, since he's an anthropologist. But one of the things that he insists upon is that, you know, the actual sort of formal characteristics of the ritual do matter. And I think in this other paper, I'll have to tackle that. I think, you know, the other answer, of course, is that ethnographically it matters. I mean, if I'm studying an ethnographic population that says, that talks about music in a certain way, then I'll pay attention to that. But I think in a more sort of theoretical sense, you know, in terms of what I'm trying to write now about musical performance as a medium of value, then I think I will try to theorize, you know, how can we talk, or how can we talk about, you know, I don't want to say the music itself, but, you know, in a broader sense, how do we talk about sort of properties of music as the thing that sort of communicates this value to people in the community? And that's kind of how Graeber talks about it. But as I say, he only gives it a few pages, so. And it's proving to be a pretty difficult paper to write, so we'll see what happens. All this is to say that, you know, I'm very much interested in that question, but I certainly did bracket it out for the purposes of this paper. Now I've lost track of what else you said. I'm sorry. I took notes at the beginning, and then.
We don't have enough time.
Oh.
Do we have? If there's one very quick question, we can have one more very quick question. I noticed many people are wrapped up in blankets and shawls. It's extremely cold in here. Yeah. So maybe it's time to get out into the relative warmth. Could we thank Professor Taylor again for a very interesting talk? And thank you.